All right, welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
And I'm Katie Halper.
And this is Useful Idiots?
Again, it's still Useful Idiots.
it's still Useful Idiots.
Yeah, all these seconds later, yeah.
Amazing.
Great show. We got a great show for you today.
We do. We have
Ro Khanna, Representative Ro Khanna, who represents the 17th District in California.
And is?
Oh, and is the co-chair of the Bernie Sanders for President campaign.
And is?
Friend of the show.
No, I'm kidding. I was going to see how long I could string that along.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's great.
Is an expert on defense spending. Yep. Is a stalwart presence. Yep, man.
Is the grandson of someone who fought side by side with, not very violently, with Mahatma Gandhi.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
I just learned something. So that's so we have a great show. We're going to be talking to him, and we're going to go over a whole bunch of stuff on this inopportunely timed podcast because we're not going to have the New Hampshire results.
Right. But you're going to have the timeless insights that we have
This is going to be evergreen.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. You just come back to here. You like listen to it.
The wisdom is just going to be, it'll be wisdom today, tomorrow, the next day. And it could have been the day before.
Yeah. And you just apply it moving forward because I have a prediction for you.
What's your prediction?
The Dems are going to suck.
No matter what happens.
No matter what, yeah. So you can take comfort in this.
Take that to the bank.
Yeah, take that to the bank. This will be nonstop catharsis.
Right.
Until Bernie Sanders is president, at which point it'll reform.
I'm beginning to, okay, yes.
Don't even say those words.
You don't want me to go there?
What, that you think he's not going to win?
I'm seeing scenarios.
Okay, I'm in New York. It's a blue state, but I'm not going to vote for anyone besides Sanders. There, I'm saying it.
Really?
Because having non-Bernies creates Trump.
Mm-hmm.
Not just because I like Bernie more than anyone else, which I do.
Right.
And also, whatever, it's fine because no one else will win. So it won't be a big deal.
I think any one of the Democrats could. I think people overestimate Trump as some kind of juggernaut. He's not. He's just, you know, at this point, he's kind of worked his way back to being more or less relatively a normal incumbent Republican.
A normie, yeah.
You know, in terms of his political strength, but.
Well, you know who definitely could win, actually? Yep. I was being very stupid and naive through the art of humor. Amy Klobuchar.
Yeah, I don't know about that. Well, she could win.
How would your hair
fare
in a blizzard?
Oh, my God. This is so painful.
And I didn't mean to be. I should have warned you. There should have been a trigger warning. I didn't realize you had heard that in person when you were covering the trail, that you'd heard it like 3 times.
Yeah.
So I didn't check in with you. Was that okay?
No, it's a little scarring. It's one of those things where if I hear it 3 more times, I might, you know, go running off on a tri-state killing rampage.
Right, yeah, so we definitely need. So, Amy, you got to not say it again.
Right.
Amy, if you're listening to this, So
you'll be saving dozens of lives.
Yeah. Please don't re-victimize Matt. So, speaking of them sucking as much as they do, should we start with the four food groups?
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, and also, buy merch.
Buy merch,
rate and review, all that jazz.
Not only should you buy these mugs, which are fantastic gifts, we want you to photograph yourself with the mugs.
Yeah.
And actually, additionally, if you could photograph yourself while doing something inappropriate with these mugs.
Illegal, that could even hopefully.
Illegal would be good.
Not inappropriate or illegal, let's be real.
Not severely illegal.
Not severely inappropriate either. Like, not problematic inappropriate. Okay, like, you could be on the toilet, yes.
Yes. Anyway, yes, but send us a photo of yourself with the mug, and we'll hashtag it out there.
And if you see anyone with, I don't know if Pod Save America has any merch, but if they do, just light it on fire.
Right.
And take photos or videos of that.
So for Democrats,
Democrats suck
this week.
There's, like, so much. But let's start with the fact that, 2 things about Iowa. One is that some voters are concerned, understandably, that the Nevada Democratic Party has hired a former Buttigieg campaign staffer to be part of its, like, fair voting oversight committee. Emily Goldman, who's identified as a former staffer of the Pete Buttigieg campaign, has been hired by the state party of Nevada. She's going to be the new voter protection director for Nevada.
Okay. We should have a little go back and forth about this. There's 2 things about this narrative that
are very smart on my part.
All right. Well, let's go with the whole relationship between Pete and Shadow.
Yeah,
which
sure.
Is,
yeah.
I think people misunderstood that a little bit.
Oh.
The Buttigieg campaign hired Shadow. Right. Shadow is a client of Buttigieg, which means that they got their money the same way they got the money from the Biden campaign to do texting and stuff like that. That doesn't mean they were an investor.
Sure. You know? You know, the media did, they would talk about in both ways. And I think what happens is this happens with law issues too. Like, when things are slightly complicated like this, one person says it incorrectly and all these other journalists copy it.
Right.
So a lot of people were saying they both were clients, they were paid by him, and also, like, donated.
Well, we don't know exactly what the relationship was there, but it doesn't appear that they, you know, it looks like it was a bill for services type of thing.
Right. And what were they doing? Were they developing an app?
Some kind of communication or other. I mean, you know, for the Biden campaign, it was texting. That's what we knew. Right. But, you know, and they spent four times as much as the Biden campaign did.
Joe, 303.
303-0.
Oh, yeah.
If you agree with me, go to Joe 303-30 and help me in this fight. Thank you very much.
They must have been happy. I wonder if he hired them before or after that.
Right. The other thing that Pete, you know, his declaration of victory with 0% of the returns in, it's a little slimy, but I think you can we can comfortably say that they would have had an idea of how well they would have done at that point. So
especially if they.
If they were behind it.
Yeah.
Dun, dun,
I'll be the conspiracy theorist. You can be the voice of reason. Yeah.
All right. I'm just going to say that, you know, I don't trust him at all. Yeah. But I don't see his hand so much in what happened in Iowa.
We also don't want to come off as anti-Woodchuck. Woodchucks are fine. He's also been called a rat and rat-faced. And I do want to say I'm a little worried because you know what this year is in the Chinese zodiac?
It's the year of the rat?
Yeah.
Interesting. For me, the big comparison with Pete Buttigieg is
that guy.
It's Patrick Bateman.
I know, yeah. Oh, that's the coach? No.
Oh, well, no. He's facially, he's Brad Stevens, but his delivery is pure American Psycho.
Oh, that's who Patrick... Okay, I thought you meant Jason Bateman for a second.
Yeah, if you really want to see... do a comparison with, you know, Pete Buttigieg, look at the speech that Patrick Bateman gives in Espace, the restaurant in American Psycho, and then compare that with any Pete Buttigieg
and then
speech.
Physically the love child of that coach
and Brad Stevens.
a woodchuck and then the other issue that's terrible, so I really couldn't separate these two. Democrats suck, but there was a really important revelation that Tripp Gabriel made, journalist. So the Iowa Democratic Party chair Troy Price, this was revealed by journalist Tripp Gabriel to New York Times. Troy Price sent an email, internal email, that the party attorney says any reexamination of precinct results cannot change the results on caucus math worksheets, even if they are wrong. Okay. That's like a little problematic. And then he quotes the opinion of the IDP attorney. The incorrect math on the caucus math worksheets must not be changed to ensure the integrity of the process. Most importantly, the worksheet is the caucus chair and secretary's certification of the results is required by Iowa code, blah, blah, blah. It is the legal voting record of the caucus, like a ballot. So they're saying in order to ensure the integrity of the process, we must maintain the errors of the tally.
Yeah, I don't know how they justify that. Because I think what they're saying is it'd be one thing if they were talking about somebody counting incorrectly, right? So then you're weighing one person's count versus some.
It's like a he said, right?
But this is like if the calculations for SDEs are wrong or for delegates are wrong, they just should fix that.
It's a rounding question, right? I think that's what this is. It's a rounding up, rounding down.
Rounding up, rounding down. Yeah, they should, like in one case, for instance, that it should have been 5-3-2. In one district, and they made it 4-4-2, right? And
yeah.
So if they're not fixing that, is that what we're talking about here? Then that's just stupid. I don't understand.
Right.
That.
Anyway, so those are your Democrats suck for today.
All right. So for Republicans suck, we didn't get this in time last week. So
it's important to
Trump giving the Medal of Freedom to Rush Limbaugh. I think we didn't give this appropriate. What's the word?
Airtime?
Truck last week. We didn't give this enough attention.
Yeah.
Because this is really ridiculous. Like, first of all, let's just take a look at the video of Trump giving the Presidential Medal of Freedom to Rush Limbaugh.
Here tonight is a special man, beloved by millions of Americans, who just received a stage 4 advanced cancer diagnosis. This is not good news. But what is good news
is
that he is the greatest fighter and winner that you will ever meet. Rush Limbaugh, thank you for your decades of tireless devotion to our country.
This is at the State of the Union, by the way, so and he's getting Rush Limbaugh's getting standing up. Bowing his head, clapping for himself. just did the truck. Speaking about, just talking about truck, he did the, what's that called?
I don't know, like the air horn, whatever.
The air horn. Yeah. Now he's doing a fist over the heart, like a pounding the fist, right.
And Rush, in recognition of all that you have done for our nation, the millions of people
Nancy,
a day that you speak to and that you inspire, and all of the incredible work that you have done for charity, I am proud to announce tonight that you will be receiving our country's highest civilian honor, the Presidential Medal of Freedom.
He looks like...
He's clearly surprised.
Yeah. Wait, do you think he didn't... Was that...
Okay.
Okay, now he's... So he has his hands in... His face is in his hand, like he's really moved. Rush Limbaugh. He's having... His eyes are watering.
First of all, it's pretty clear from the video that he was surprised.
Yeah.
He's like, they fucking did what? You know?
Right.
Like,
he just thought he was going to get honored.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Even he thought, like, wow, I'm not sure that's
right. He thought he'd get a shout out. Well, it makes sense because Donald Trump is like a game, you know, he is a reality TV star.
Right.
So he's like, and I'd like to announce, he's announcing it. It's like not built into the script. It's reality TV. It's not, you know.
Yeah,
it's not
I mean, it was like, you know, Rush Limbaugh, a new, you win a new car.
I know. And like, then when he said he had stage four cancer, it was like he was reading an exciting development about him, like a new breaking news that was good.
Right.
In fact, you think that it almost sounds like Trump himself had to explain to himself that it wasn't good.
Yeah.
Because he's like, and he just found out that he has stage four cancer.
Which is not
good news.
Yeah.
But what is good news, right?
That's right. That's right. I'm just speechless by this move.
We should do it.
And you know, for this kind of media person, and you know, who knows, I might even fall into this category. The reward you get for saying outrageous shit and being somebody like that is while you're in the prime of your career. You get the money and you get the attention and all that. And he got all of that in spades. And he had enormous influence over politics that he probably shouldn't have.
Oh, yeah. I can't even remember. What did he do to call a bunch of people sluts? I think he called friend of the show Crystal Ball a slut. Sandra Fluke.
Yeah, Sandra Fluke. It's such an FU to give the Presidential Medal of Freedom to Rush Limbaugh.
I know, who said so much racist. What has he done for freedom?
He used to be just a run-of-the-mill good radio DJ. And, you know, he just made this heel turn to become like an evil political
Like he
partisan.
Played music? He was just a DJ?
Yeah, he was like a top 40 DJ, I think in Pittsburgh, if I'm not mistaken. If you look up to those, he wasn't bad. He was, you know, he could spin a record. And you can hear that his broadcast ability is actually pretty good when he's just doing shticks and stuff like that on the show. Like he's a media professional.
Yeah, he's engaging.
But he just made a financial decision, I think, more than anything.
Right.
And I don't know. That was a real Republican suck moment. So we can move on. What do we got for Isn't That Weird?
For Isn't That Weird, we have a cautionary tale for anyone who's ever dressed up as a Disney character. So this took place on a Las Vegas strip. So a woman dressed in a Minnie Mouse costume looks like she punched a security guard before two others dressed as Mickey Mouse and Goofy intervened to break up the fight. So Minnie Mouse is like really going after this. It's a Minnie Mouse woman going after a female security guard. I don't know. I wonder what the security guard had said to her or had done. And then luckily, the security guard is basically saved by someone who had, I guess, a Goofy costume on, but he's like holding it. I like that they break the code, the Disney wall.
Right.
That usually exists, you know, of impunity.
Yeah, they're breaking kayfabe, basically.
What's that?
That's like the wrestling code. You're not supposed to break the suspension of disbelief.
Got it. Yeah, so you can see that like one of them was wearing a Goofy outfit, but because he, I guess, threw himself into the fight, he lost his head. Not literally. He lost his Goofy head.
He lost his Goofy head.
Yeah. So I guess thank you to Goofy.
Any story that involves mascots or people in costumes like violence. That, like, Yeah, because I just love the real people coming out underneath. It's always good.
Oh, like Crazy Crab.
Crazy Crab, yeah.
Exactly, the Santa Con fight, yeah.
Also a good one. Isn't that terrible? This is a avalanche in Turkey. So what's the value of this story? Like, snow is dangerous. It's, you know, depending on where you live, all around you. It may be on top of your house, so you could die just by walking outside your house. But this is more like an avalanche on the side of a mountain in Turkey. An avalanche of bad news. And this is 33 were killed, 53 were injured in Turkey when a bunch of people went to go try to save people from a previous avalanche.
Right, so during a search for missing people missing from a snow slide, which makes it sound like a ride.
Okay, so why do you have disaster stories on the news all the time? People love to read stories about terrible things that are happening to other people somewhere else, right? It's also an incentive for you not to leave your home. This is an additional message on top of that, which is just don't ever try to help anybody else, right?
Yeah.
Because if you go off and try to help somebody in a disaster zone, you may end up becoming a victim of a second disaster.
Yeah, what's even worse is that, like, only 5 people were killed and 2 people went missing in the initial avalanche.
Yeah, so they compounded it by...
Not just compounded it. It's like by... how many times is 5 going to 33?
Six or seven.
Over 6.
Yeah.
So 6 times as many people died. I disagree. I don't like the message. I'm a not me us person.
Uh-huh.
But it is true that make sure you, when you do it, you're smart.
So that was terrible.
So, you know, we should just start a tradition called our Chris Matthews of the Week. This is a very important video that I want to make sure we share with our listeners.
I have my own views of the word socialist, and I'll be glad to tell them, share them with you in private. And they go back to the early 1950s. I have an attitude about them. I remember the Cold War. I have an attitude towards Castro. I believe if Castro and the Reds had won the Cold War, there would have been executions in Central Park, and I might have been one of the ones getting executed. And certain other people would be there cheering, okay? So I have a problem with people who took the other side. I don't know who Bernie supports over these years. I don't know what he means by social. 1 week it's Denmark. We're going to be like Denmark. Okay, that's harmless. That's basically a capitalist country with a lot of good social welfare programs. Denmark is harmless.
It's pretty clearly in the Denmark category, yeah.
Are you sure? How do you know? Did he tell you that?
Well, I mean, that's what he says, and that's what his agenda calls for, right?
Let's figure that one out.
But we haven't seen a campaign yet where video of him praising the other version,
right,
which is Castro, has been used.
Well, but
will be used.
That's a question
we haven't
of how,
seen how that plays.
Of how tangible, what the effect that has.
Well, what does he think of Castro? That's a great question. What did you think of Fidelismo? We all thought he was great when he first, I thought he was cheering like mad for him when he first went in. And then he became a communist and started shooting every one of his enemies.
Okay, hold those thoughts on Cuban Revolution. I have to go back to the spin room and Democratic presidential candidate.
That's amazing. First of all,
good shit, man.
First of all, yeah, that's a stone moment. First of all, so much to unpack there. He starts off by saying he has some opinions that he's going to keep private.
But except for the ones that I'm not going to, yeah.
Right? I have an attitude. By the way, I'm going to start this tradition where I recite my own tweets, if you don't mind. Chris Matthews is a slightly delusional, lifelong drunk of an uncle who's especially drunk at a family function. Chris Hayes is the wholesome, mortified nephew trying to quiet his uncle. Joanne Reed is a sober sister-in-law who should know better, but is egging Matthews on.
It's good. I like it. First, can I just interject and say that I'm familiar with that situation, and I like the uncle.
Right.
Yes. That situation.
Yeah. He just.
I'm always secretly rooting for that uncle.
Right. You just don't necessarily want him on national television.
Right. That's true. Yes.
I mean, I cannot get over that. I know I should, and it makes me naive, but I cannot get over
that. To boil down what he's saying, I'm concerned that Bernie Sanders might have me shot in Central Park.
Yeah. This is really like a psychologist or psychiatrist, like, gold mine. It's a treasure trove. Like, Chris Matthews is revealing so much about his inner monologues, about his psychology, about his anxieties, his fears of being shot in Central Park, his fears of communism. He's straight up out of, like, he's probably, I wonder if he, like, his default mode is just hiding under a desk.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is so old school Red Scare. And he feels very emasculated by communism, I think, by Fidel Castro.
Okay, I'm going to push back on this. Uh-oh. I'm going to do the devil's advocate thing, because I think what a lot of people are responding to, there are a lot of people who grew up in the Cold War. I mean, the communists have a legitimately horrifying record. They murdered, you know, tens of millions of people.
Sure.
And, you know, and not just in one place either. There are lots of many different regimes where there are all kinds of atrocities. So
we have them too, though. Capitalists have those too.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. The Nazis have them, but the I think it's sometimes lost as a discussion point on the left.
Yeah.
That there is that kind of political
violence. He's a democratic socialist. Like, that's what he makes
Sanders
clear.
Has nothing to do with any of that.
He sounds like a crazy person, Chris Matthews. Like,
yes.
Why is he actually afraid that Bernie Sanders' election will result in Central Park executions where people are cheering? What's up with the cheering it on thing? I guess he's maybe in that case, the Sanders supporters are the people cheering on the Central Park executions.
They're the Bernie bros. Yeah, like, kill,
yeah,
kill,
yeah,
kill,
kill, yeah.
Right? Yeah.
And then you got Joanne Reed.
Oh, I know.
Smiling. Smiling as Chris Matthews engages in this insanity. Does she say anything to push back? No. Her response is, well, we haven't seen how a campaign video against Sanders in the Soviet Union or something will run. Now, this is why this is so disingenuous. The media does this a lot. They pretend that they're just reporting on what the other media will do, but they are the other media. Like, they're pretending that this will be seen. She even said that it was a liability that Sanders, you know, sided with the Sandinistas. I'm like, have you ever read about the Contras? They skin people. They were skinners.
Right.
Terrorists, like, that was their official policy. Any human rights organization would tell you that, even, like, totally, like, mealy-mouthed moderate ones. So the fact that Joanne Reed, in a tweet from a couple years ago, says that that Sanders siding with the Sandinistas was one of his liabilities. No, you're saying that. Like, it's not an inevitability, right? And the media often reports on framing as an inevitability as opposed to this framing that they're in which they're complicit.
Yeah.
Like, Sidney Emmer did not have to write that weird hit piece about Sanders being at a rally in Nicaragua where some people said death to the Yankees.
Right. Like, allegedly.
And asked him if he. So this is just ridiculous. And the Joanne Reed thing is almost scarier than the Chris Matthews thing, because Chris Matthews just looks like an insane drunk uncle, as usual.
This is going to be part of the playbook going forward, which is Sanders is not uncomfortable with the word socialist.
Right.
And so they're going to equate socialism with everyone from Stalin to Pol Pot Castro to some others who are not so great.
Right.
And, you know, they're going to set up the question as, is he like the good socialism or the evil head chopping socialism?
Also, I don't really, he's like so stupid about this. Yeah, Castro became a communist because the United States, like, he started out as more of a nationalist, and if you want to talk about history and, like, what the lessons are from the Cold War, the United States, like, pushed him into this because they forced him into the arms of the Soviet Union.
Yeah, it's a similar situation to Ho Chi Minh or whatever, but, yeah.
You're an insane person, Chris Matthews, and you're so lazy. Like, look at the guy's platform. As Chris Hayes points out,
it's completely over the top. Like, you know, is Bernie Sanders going to shoot me in Central Park? Is crazy.
But so, I think we should start a new feature. Like, we have the four basic food groups. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that weird? Democrats suck. Republicans suck. I was going to say Central Park execution of the week.
Okay.
Where we decide who would be metaphorically executed in Central Park, do we say like paintball shot? Could we have them paintball shot in Central Park? Paintball victim of the week.
Let's just say, you know, if we were in charge of the country, these are the people we would send to Central Park for something. Yeah.
Central Park list of the week.
Central
Park visitor of the week. Stone moments.
Again, Joe Biden had a great one this week. So let's go to the videotape.
We're in New Hampshire, right?
Hi, my name is Madison, and I'm an econ student at Mercer University. And awesome. So I'm going to be a little bit mean for a second, okay? So, so you're arguably the candidate with the greatest advantage in this race. You've been the vice president. You weren't burdened down by the impeachment trials. So how do you explain the performance in Iowa, and why should the voters believe that you can win the national election?
It's a good question. Number one, Iowa is a Democratic caucus. You ever been to a caucus? No, you haven't. You're a lying dog-faced pony soldier. You said you were, but now you got to be honest. I'm going to be honest with you.
Lying dog-faced pony soldier.
Because she brought up that he didn't do well in Iowa, his pushback to that is like, well, he's about to explain the caucuses, the caucus system, right?
Yeah.
He asked her if she knows what it is.
She says yes.
She says yes. And then that's when he calls her a lying...
A lying dog-faced pony soldier. Yeah. And so I think it's actually come up in this show before. He has said this before.
We couldn't understand it, right?
I had heard him say something once and I didn't understand what he was saying.
Yes.
And let's look at the videotape. Yes. He said it in an exchange about a month ago.
Yeah.
Mr. Obama, President Obama promised my father that if he likes his plan, he can keep his plan, because his insurance will be cheaper. After passage, his plan is no longer allowed, and his insurance costs doubled. Since you supported the plan, were you lying to my dad, or did you not understand the bill you supported?
Lying dog-faced pony soldier. No, look.
Okay.
There's two ways people know.
But it's weird because he called that guy a lying dog-faced pony soldier, even though he said right after, yes, you're right. Because he was saying that no one understood Obamacare and he was admitting that it had problems.
Yeah.
So is he calling Obama a lying dog-faced pony soldier?
No, he was calling the kid, basically. Well, it's not clear
because
the kid was saying, were you lying then or will you
right.
were you lying
oh,
now?
Maybe he was
so
like,
you might
are
have
you,
just sort
yeah.
of inadvertently.
Anyway, it's from a John Wayne movie?
No, it's I don't know if John Wayne's in it. It's a Tyrone Power movie.
Oh, okay.
The movie is actually called Pony Soldier. I did actually see this movie once upon a time, years ago. It's like a really kind of weird Western with a lot of people who are not Native Americans playing Native Americans. And Tyrone Power. There's a line in this movie, Pony Soldier, where somebody calls him lying dog-faced pony soldier. So this movie is from when? 1952?
Yeah, it's a recent hit.
So that's only, 67 years ago?
Right.
68 years ago?
It was back when Joe Biden was, right before he
back
started
when Joe
working
Biden was a mere 58 years old.
Yeah.
Or whatever it
right,
is.
Exactly, right, exactly, yeah. Right before he was working as a civil rights advocate by being a lifeguard at a black pool where the black children would admire his golden leg hair.
Yeah, his golden leg hair. So this is just weird, right?
Yeah.
I think he's to say that, you have to assume that people know where the line comes from.
Right. No, not Joe. Not Biden. He doesn't care.
He doesn't care? So if you're just randomly blurting out at a crowd lying dog-faced pony soldier,
right,
and people don't make the association.
Yeah. I guess I don't think he has that much forethought. Did he think the golden leg hair thing would resonate? At least I guess people understand that. It's weird.
I think if you make a cultural reference randomly,
yeah,
you have to have some expectation that the audience is going
right
to know what it is.
No, but I think you're right. What makes this stone as opposed to just Joe Biden being Joe Biden is that we're used to him saying really inappropriate things. Like he could have easily just called someone a lying dog.
Right.
Like he would have done that. You could imagine him doing that.
Yeah.
But it's like, there's the element that he failed for Biden because he used a cultural reference that doesn't land.
Yeah.
It's not the outrageous insult that's weird for Biden. That's just your standard Biden.
It's a little weird, too, that he...
He's
so hostile to people. And this is part of the thing that I wrote about in my piece from Iowa. Just that he goes from zero to hostile in a second,
right,
you know, and
he and Chris Matthews should hang out.
Yeah. I mean, when people give any indication that they're not there to like tell Joe how awesome he is,
yeah,
he suddenly goes completely defensive and he says, you know, if you don't like me,
vote
for someone else, like screw you, basically.
Yeah.
There's a great scene from Iowa when he was like grabbing somebody by the jacket lapel and asking the guy to explain why, you know, and it turned out the guy was actually... He thought the guy was a Bernie supporter. It turned out he was a Steyer supporter, and he relaxed his hands.
Not as threatened
hands
by Steyer.
Yeah,
he wants
exactly.
To make sure
Steyer, oh, Steyer,
gives
good.
Money.
You know, so he's pretty weird, and I think this is getting progressively worse.
Do
the
we
situation.
Have, right? I guess I'm just saying that's not weird. We're used to him being weirdly abusive to his people who question him at all. So the only thing that makes this stoned, remember, the threshold
right,
for
yes,
Biden stoned is a lot different from normal people.
That's true.
So what makes this comment worthy
is that he's
is
throwing
that
out a
he's,
random
yeah, exactly,
cultural
yeah,
reference that,
right,
you know,
the
from
other thing
67
is,
years ago
right,
or 68 years ago.
The other thing is just Biden being Biden.
Yeah.
Do we have a video of Biden Can you look for really quickly, Biden? Why?
Mr. Vice President. Why attack Sanders?
Why? You're getting nervous, man. Just calm down. It's okay.
And I love the way he goes, why? And then he like, calm down, man, as if he's the one freaking out.
Yeah, exactly. And then for me, this gets into my whole Biden Nosferatu thesis.
Oh,
like
yeah.
When he goes wrong, his first the fangs come out,
yeah,
and he reaches this
with
way,
his hands, yeah.
Right. And you'll see him, you know, the way I put it in the piece is that he looks like he wants to pull people in by the ears and speed eat their faces,
you know?
Like that's kind of the thing, and he does that repeatedly.
I was a little offended by that reference because you were invisibilizing Cory Booker, who we used to credit as the one who the real face eater in the race.
Right. Yeah. No, but Biden,
it's different. Yeah. Yeah, he there's like a soul suction too that would happen.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
that's
which
true.
Wouldn't happen with Cory Booker.
Yeah.
And to be fair, Cory Booker would never eat your face. He just has that
intensity. Look, yeah, his
right,
eyes.
Exactly,
yeah, no.
Eyes,
Biden, I think, is a real threat to actually physically bite someone in this over the course.
I like the way the reporter's laughing.
Yeah, yeah,
like
exactly.
Freaked out, obviously. No,
well, that's the same thing. Not to go on about this too much, but the guy he poked in Iowa, this guy Ed Fallon. There was a moment when Biden was poking him and he's saying, "Do you think Bernie's going to do something for you in 2020?" And the guy's like, "Dude, I support Steyer." You know, like at that moment, he gave the same kind of uncomfortable, like, "Thank God he's not going to like eat me."
Oh,
look,
right, yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So you see that a lot in Biden interactions, that kind of like uncomfortable, nervous response.
It's like a safety word.
Yeah.
Whatever non-Bernie candidate.
Stump Steyer.
Yeah. Amy Klobuchar.
Amy Klobuchar.
Another story from Mayor Pete's campaign is that Jordan Sheridan, who's a journalist, he and his cameraman.
Saw Jordan in Iowa.
Oh, yeah. So I don't know if this is before or after, but he and his cameraman were told to leave. They were followed around. They were said that they didn't have, like, they weren't allowed to be there. And this is something that happened to his cameraman, who had his credentials literally, like, just grabbed. They just took them off of his chest or whatever.
Let's
listen to the videotape. Yeah.
Like I said, I went through an ordeal where I was just filming, doing my job as a journalist. A lady walked up to me and she just ripped the credentials right off my jacket and then spoke to me, said, "Hey, I don't think that you guys are supposed to have credentials. I don't think you guys are supposed to be here." And I'm like, well, before I could explain and ask, how did I get a name tag with my name on it if I snuck in? I was like, listen, I'm going to talk to my boss, all right? We're going to walk over there. You're not kicking me out before I have a word. And that's how we got into the argument.
So, wait. To be clear, she came up to you and ripped your name tag off before she said anything.
She ripped my name tag off and then said, "I'm sorry, I don't think you're supposed to have credentials. You just ripped my credential right off me."
And then,
I'm not stupid.
Can we just back up just for a second?
Yeah.
This whole issue of credentials with media credentials at campaign events is just stupid. Like, 99 times out of 100, it's a completely casual thing. Like, you call them up on the day and you say, "I work for X outlet," and they say, "Okay," and they put you on a list. There's no vetting procedure. There's no security, anything. They just put you on a list and you go in.
Right.
You can show up without one
and
say, I work for, you know, the Daily Atrocity in China or whatever it is,
And
they'll put you in the list. Like, they don't care.
Right.
All right? And most campaigns are happy to have as much press as they want. The only reason anybody would ever go out of their way to take your credential away is if they know you're giving you bad press, which is just stupid.
Right, because guess what gives you really bad press now?
I don't know why they would bother doing this. It's just so silly.
And his cameraman, by the way, just wanted, his Twitter name is Cinematic Jones, and the show is called Status Quo.
So since we had a positive reaction last week when we talked a little bit of sports, got to ask you, do you like the Wiggins trade?
I feel conflicted. Not sure.
What are you conflicted about?
On the one hand,
does it make them better next year or not?
Well, that's what I'm conflicted about. It could make them better. It could also make them worse.
Well, look, when they get all their horses back, is he going to be a guy who's going to be happy being the number four or five option on that kind of a team?
I mean, I think he'd be happier being the one.
That's
number
right.
One.
Which is why he should have stayed in
in Idaho. Where should he have stayed?
Minnesota.
In Minnesota. And what sport is this?
This is basketball.
He should have stayed in Minnesota. It's cold. but he's number one.
Right.
And now he's in
Golden State.
Golden State, which is California.
California, yes.
Yeah. So he's warm, but he's number four or five.
Right.
So
yeah.
I think the whole, you know, meteorology is very important in sports analysis.
I think the rationale for the Warriors here was really just not so much about the personnel, but about the draft compensation.
They're
getting Minnesota's slightly protected number one pick for next year. How do you feel about that? Do you feel more protected? Not just slightly protected. Like, so you want enhanced protection for the pick for next year?
Yeah.
You do.
More security.
Okay. What do you think about what Miami did? You know what drives me crazy about Miami? No space. They have no assets, nothing. But they're somehow always able to pull off these deals. How does Pat Riley do this?
I think the dolphin imagery. Am I right? They're dolphins, right?
Oh, they're heat.
There's some Miami dolphins.
Yeah, that's football.
Exactly. I think the dolphin imagery is so compelling that it transfers over from the football. It doesn't even matter what genre of sport it is. There's just such a strong association with Miami dolphins.
And dolphins.
And dolphins are a loving, peace-loving species. They save people's lives. They really do. They're like the Bernie Sanders of sea mammals.
Okay.
I've been swimming. Now, full disclosure, I've been swimming with them.
So that accounts for your bias.
Yeah,
in this segment.
And I like to be as rigorous and objective in my sports analysis as I am in my politics analysis.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that that definitely we can't dismiss that. Also, the heat.
Yeah.
Again, warm weather.
Right.
It's just so inviting. So they don't have assets. They don't have space.
So how do you explain the deal from Memphis's side? I mean, they took on a lot of money just to get Justice Winslow. I mean, what do you think about that?
Well, they're very committed to fairness.
It's justice with an S, not with a C.
No matter how it's spelled, justice is justice. Goes back to what we're saying about the law versus justice. Maybe because you're more of a Scalia type, you don't get it.
Right.
But people like me of the Thurgood Marshall tradition, we see justice and we prioritize that. Justice Winslow?
Yes.
I think that having the name Win in it, although there's also slow, so it's a real gamble. They don't know if he's going to be a winner or a slowpoke.
Right. I see. So he could bring a winning culture to them.
Right.
But he could also slow the process.
But
right?
Maybe it's like slow and steady wins the race.
Right. Yes.
Because people don't talk enough about how track and field lessons apply to basketball.
Do they apply to basketball? They could, yeah.
I mean, Bernie Sanders, and this is actually a very important point, and I'm glad I'm here to make it, he's good at both basketball and long distance track.
Mm-hmm.
So
Bernie Sanders into both of these analogies.
I think that the reason that I'm going to go out on a limb and say, from what I know, because I'm someone who watches a lot of sports, I think that the reason that Sanders is so good at basketball is because he brings that long distance runner je ne sais quoi to it.
Right.
Also why he's good at running races. He can go the distance.
And why fitness is really important in basketball because
you got to jump to put the balls in the hoops.
Right.
You can't travel.
Right. That's true.
So you got to have good leg muscle action. Mm-hmm. You got to be able to stop yourself.
Yeah.
Because if not, you're going to wobble all over.
No, I hear what you're saying.
Here's what I will say. If we had to choose between Winslow and a lose fast.
You'd rather Winslow?
I think, so I think they made the right choice because it could have been a lose fast. I think Pat Riley.
Yes.
I like Pat Riley.
You do.
He's consistent.
He's good hair.
He's been around for a while. Mm-hmm. His hair's consistent. Mm-hmm. His coaching's consistent. His wrinkles haven't moved that much.
Not too much.
I feel like he's good. They don't go anywhere.
Right.
Other people's, they expand.
So overall, interesting trade deadline.
What do you think? Where do you fall on it?
I thought it was an interesting deadline. There were a lot of deals made.
Good or bad, though?
Most of them were good for all the teams combined. I don't really understand it from Golden State's point of view.
They're always a mystery, Golden State. They're foggy.
Well, except for the last 5 years of total dominance, but yeah.
Right, but the motives are always mysterious.
Mysterious,
I find them mysterious,
right,
even though it works out. So
and
maybe
I didn't like that deal for Memphis. I didn't like the Iguodala deal. I thought that was a mistake.
Iguodala.
They had a chance to really to really bleed the heat, and they didn't do it. And so great insights.
Thank
Terrific.
You.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Yeah.
Actually,
yeah.
not thank you. You're welcome. So excited
yep.
to interview Congressman Representative Ro Khanna.
Yep.
Great guy. Represents California 17th District.
Native of Philly, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes. Philly mm-hmm. born, Philly raised, a jurist.
Mm-hmm.
Also the vice, also a co-chair of the Bernie Sanders for President campaign.
Wow. We've never had anybody associated with that campaign on this show.
What's his name? Bernie Wu? Who? I didn't mean Wu. Who? Yeah.
No, we're looking forward to talking.
Yeah.
So let's do it.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me on.
You are a renaissance man of politics. Many causes that you're a champion for. You're also the co-chair of the Bernie Sanders for President campaign. If you could tell us your thoughts on the latest in Iowa and moving forward in New Hampshire.
Starting with the imbroglio in yeah. Iowa.
Yeah.
Well, look, we did very well in Iowa. As you know, we got the most votes. Obviously, we lost very narrowly the state delegate equivalent. But at the end of the day, we showed that we brought out young people. We brought out minority communities. We brought out labor, working families. And I think that's the coalition we're going to need to win. And I'm very, very confident headed into New Hampshire that we're going to win there. And then we go to Nevada, where we're very strong. So we may have a sense here of having won the popular vote in Iowa, winning in New Hampshire, and then winning in Nevada, which will put us in very strong shape for the nomination.
Are you certain that you lost the state delegate equivalence in Iowa? Is that a certainty at this point?
It's not. You know, I know that our campaign is asking for some of the precincts to be recounted because we're fighting for every delegate. But the blame here really is not, in my view, with the Iowa party or the people in Iowa. I have full confidence that people in Iowa are honest and they've been doing this for 50 years. The blame is with the DNC. I mean, why was Tom Perez not involved in getting a good app there? Why were they not allowed to do virtual caucuses? Why didn't they have a system reform if they were going to then move more towards a popular vote like the Republicans have? So my sense is for future cycles, we'll have to have a conversation about certain reforms in the caucus and better technology and infrastructure. But I really blame Perez much more than I blame the Iowa Democratic Party or the people in Iowa.
Do you think he should step down?
Well, that's not for me to say. And what I think he should do is apologize to the voters in Iowa, apologize to the state party, assume responsibility and instead of trying to blame someone else and work with them to reform the process for the future. And he also has a lot of work to do, candidly, with the Congressional Black Caucus, the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, with members of Congress. So, you know, I think he needs to be a little more willing to listen to other perspectives.
We could send him an agenda. We'll send him a plan that he has to follow and he can check off, a checkoff list.
Yeah, well, let me just say they're not, I've never heard positive comments about him on the floor of Congress, especially recently. So he's got a lot of work to do.
And what is that, there's that rule that they're recounting, but you can't correct it? Like if you see a rounding error, you can't correct it. You just have to make sure that you've copied over the number.
Yeah, look, I think they have to reform this.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you know, you need 1,990 delegates to win. We have to look forward. Yes, we have to make sure we fight for every delegate, but what's going to matter is how does Bernie Sanders build a broad coalition? How do
right.
we unify the party so that if he has a plurality of the delegates, he wins at the DNC? And my advice to him and my focus of the campaign is let's win New Hampshire, let's move forward,
yeah.
let's be unifying.
Yeah.
And let's let Trump demagogue this issue. I mean, the next day Trump is saying, well, New Hampshire and Iowa will never lose their status while I'm president. Why is he saying that? Because he knows that Iowa and New Hampshire are both swing states, and they both of them, Obama carried both of them, and then we lost Iowa to Hillary Clinton. We can easily carry that state this time, especially given the president's policies, which have hurt farmers with the trade war, which have hurt farmers because of his waivers for oil companies and not having ethanol as part of that. So we ought not to let the Republicans win in this whole mess.
Congressman, I want to move on to a topic that I spent a lot of time on, but you absolutely have in the last years, few years especially, which is defense spending. First, if you could explain to people who don't know what the AUMF is, and then tell us about your efforts to repeal that and what the latest status of that is.
I appreciate that. That has been one of my biggest causes in Congress, to end the war in Yemen, to stop a war in Iran, and working with Barbara Lee, who's a profile in Courage, to repeal the authorization of military force. You know, in 2001, when we were hit on 9/11, everyone believed that we had to go after the terrorists who hit us. And most people supported, including me, the strikes on Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. But no one believed back then that that authorization of military force should still be applicable nearly 20 years later. And it's being used to still stay in Afghanistan for a mission that has totally changed. Now the fight isn't against Al-Qaeda, who hit us on 9/11. It's trying to take on the Taliban and create a new government. And that authorization of force, combined with the authorization of force to go after Saddam Hussein, which was wrong and which I opposed, is now being used to broadly justify almost every conflict in the Middle East and around the world. So what Barbara Lee has been saying, what I've been saying, and what many Republicans agree with, is we need to repeal this authorization of military force. 75% of Congress wasn't even there when it was passed. And let's have a new authorization that's far more limited in time and geography, that would make it clear that the president has the right to go after terrorists that are a threat, direct threat to our homeland, but doesn't give them carte blanche to have endless war.
So people are clear, the original authorization to use military force, that was pretty narrowly restricted to people who had some kind of direct connection to 9/11. That was my understanding of it. And it's since been used to target groups that weren't even in existence on 9/11. Donald Trump, I think last year, classified the entire Iranian Republican Guard as terrorists, so they could be gone after under the AUMF. It's been a total perversion of what the original concept was, isn't it?
It's been a total perversion. Now, the only person who had the foresight was Barbara Lee. I mean, she said, look, this is too broadly written. There's no restriction on time. There's no restriction on geography. It was poorly crafted. But we have to remember the mood at the time. I mean, we were in a traumatic shock as a nation when we lost all those lives in New York with the buildings coming down, and we rushed to give the Bush authorization. That language was way overbroad. Barbara Lee warned us about that. And now presidents continue to abuse it to go after, as you point out, terrorists that have no connection to 9/11. That's why it needs to be repealed. And the House voted to repeal it just 2 weeks ago, and it's now with the Senate to repeal. The reason it doesn't get repealed is because the House and Senate can't agree on what a narrow construction of authorization of force would look like. But the fact that we can't agree on the alternative is not a reason not to repeal it. If you repeal it, frankly, it will force the Congress and Senate to come up with something.
This issue came up also in the passage of the defense bill in December. And I remember you had some pretty sharp words after that was passed. I believe one member of the caucus, the Democratic caucus, says it was the most progressive defense bill ever passed. I think they were happy because there had been some family leave provisions that had been added in exchange for some pretty horrible things on the other side. Like they were gutting the prohibitions against funding the Saudi proxy war in Yemen. Can you talk about what your feelings were at the passage of that defense bill?
Well, Senator Sanders and I called it an act of moral cowardice. And let's just be clear what happened. President Obama left the defense spending at about $620 billion, and our country was safe and secure. Trump increased it in this budget by $120 billion, $740 billion higher than where Obama left it. You know what we could do for $140 billion? We could give every person in this country a free public college, free trade school, and give every kid a free school lunch, and we'd still have money left over. Now, you tell me, do you think we ought to be doing that, or we ought to be increasing the defense budget? But what is worse than the massive increase in defense that is robbing our kids of education and school lunches is that they stripped my amendment, which would have prevented the Soleimani killing. There was just an article today, actually, in a New Hampshire paper. I encourage people to read it. And the author says that my amendment would have prohibited the Soleimani killing. I had an amendment which said that the Pentagon could use no resources to go after Iran or Iranian officials. And the Pentagon fought tooth and nail to get that stripped. We would not have had that situation arise had we just said, no, you Pentagon, we're not going to fund you without that amendment. If that we had done that, we would have avoided all of this escalation in Iran. So it's important to realize this, not because I'm saying, oh, I was right or Senator Sanders was right. It's important to realize that Congress actually does have the power of the purse. We can stop these endless wars. We would have done so 2 months ago, but it was caving to the Pentagon demands that led in part to the president abusing his office and authorizing these Soleimani strikes. And at some point we have to ask, what does resistance to this president really mean? It's not just casting an impeachment vote. It's making sure that we're not giving him a carte blanche to his Pentagon.
I mean, yeah, right. What's the symbolism of tearing up a speech doesn't mean to me a whole lot compared to, I don't know, passing the defense bill in that situation. But does it ever blow your mind that people say, oh, how can we pay for X, Y, or Z, Medicare, or, you know, free higher education, when they're giving exactly those sums of money? Like, how come nobody ever says, how can we afford right. this when we do these massive, massive hikes in defense spending?
You're absolutely right. I mean, no one talks about what would the defense increase of in that budget actually afford in terms of free public college, in terms right. of school lunches, in terms of early child care. On Medicare for All, how many times have you heard, how are you going to pay for right. Medicare for All? Why doesn't anyone say, how are you going to pay for the current system? How are companies yeah. like AT&T and Verizon going to afford a payroll of 25% to 30% going for healthcare costs? Are they going to become healthcare businesses? How are we going to have Americans afford $20,000 to $24,000 of out-of-pocket expenses or premiums? How is this country going to afford $50 trillion of national health expenditure and that going up? So anytime they talk about how much is Medicare for All going to cost, our answer should be it's going to cost trillions of dollars less than the current system. Because what they try to do is to get a soundbite of how Medicare for All will cost and scare the American people. Obviously, healthcare costs money. Obviously, that's going to be a big number, which Medicare for All costs, but it's less than what the current system costs. And it's just a totally disingenuous form of yeah. argument.
To speak as a political scientist, which I'm not, but I found an inverse relationship between the number of lives saved and the number of times they will ask about how you're going to pay for it. So, like, the better something is, the more times you're going to be asked how to pay for it, and the more people something kills, the fewer times. In fact, you're never asked how you're going to pay for it when it's something like a war. Right. It's only when it's something that's actually going to save people's lives or make people's lives better that people, the media ask, how are you going to pay for it?
And the reality is, on a public option, when people keep talking about that, first of all, it's not going to solve the problem for many Americans who don't go and get prescription drugs or health care, even though they're insured, because of the costs. Right. 1 in 4 Americans who have insurance skip the proper treatment because they don't want to pay the deductible or they can't afford the prescription drug costs. The public option does nothing for them. Second, what is a public option going to be? It's going to mean the sickest people are going to end up going for the public option, and the insurance companies will game the system to have the healthier people on their insurance, and the costs will still go up. So these tough questions are not asked of the candidates who are proposing these more incremental plans. And all of the fire is directed at people proposing Medicare for All. Finally, I mean, I heard, you know, I have a lot of respect, for the vice president. I was in the Obama administration, but he said offhandedly that he wouldn't pick a running mate who was for Medicare for All, as if Medicare for All is some far left position. Yeah. Just for the record, Jimmy Carter ran on it in 76. It was part of our platform until 1980. Harry Truman was for it. Every Democratic candidate was for it until 1980. And we won swing states. Harris Wofford ran on it in 1991 to win Pennsylvania. So we can disagree philosophically, but don't let people believe that somehow it's unelectable on Medicare for All.
So you can disagree, and I mean, he's wrong, but he can say it's bad policy, but he shouldn't pretend it's bad politics, but given that it overwhelmingly also has mass support. Yeah.
That's a much more succinct way to say what I was trying to say.
Take it, run with it. You can call it the Katie Halper analysis.
Yeah.
Getting back a little bit to defense spending, because that's such a bailiwick of yours. One, could you tell people a little bit about how much their total is spent on defense? Because it's not just that $738 billion number, right? I mean, there's the Department of Energy, there's the State Department, DHS. How much total money is spent on defense when you count it all up? And if you could help people understand what overseas contingency operations are, war funding, because it seems it's a workaround around limits on defense spending, isn't it?
It is. Well, the Overseas Contingency Fund is about over 100 billion, 130, 140 billion. It's part of that 738 billion number I gave you, but it's basically a fund which the Pentagon can use for overseas wars, and that's why we need to restrict it. I mean, why would you want to give the president that kind of discretion? But you're absolutely right. The Pentagon spending is not the full story. I mean, it's well over $1 trillion when you add in all of the other agencies that are spending money on national security. And then it's trillions of dollars when you look at our obligations from these endless wars, because it's led to so many veterans who have been hurt, who have been disabled, who aren't being able to come into the workforce. Obviously, we have to do right by them. And that means that those wars have cost us and will cost us trillions of dollars. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, what would be a better investment for all these trillions of dollars in endless war? Are we safer today when we now have 40 terrorist groups, when terrorist groups are now spread to over 20 countries? Or would we have been safer and better off as a country if we had put those trillions of dollars into infrastructure, into education, into healthcare? And I think most Americans would say the latter. And Democrats shouldn't be afraid of making that case.
You've spent a lot of time focusing on waste and inefficiency in the Defense Department. I think there was a company called TransDigm that you spent a lot of time on. Obviously, the Pentagon has never passed an audit. They've spent billions of dollars getting to the point where they even have concluded that they can't pass an audit. Can you talk a little bit about some of the problems that you've uncovered?
I appreciate your bringing up TransDigm. I did that my first week in office. I got a journalist who came to me and he said, this is outrageous. This company was going up, buying small businesses that were supplying to the Pentagon, gobbling them up and raising the price 1,000%, 5,000%. It was so bad that we had a bipartisan hearing that I led. I worked on this with Senator Warren and Congressman Tim Ryan, and we had a bipartisan hearing. And even the Republicans couldn't defend in any way what TransDigm did and started being appalled at what was going on. And TransDigm had to reimburse the federal government $16 million. They admitted that they had overcharged and they wrote a check to us for $16 million. This ought to be bipartisan. You know, the reason Harry Truman became president was because of the Truman Commission, which he led as a senator, where he, in a bipartisan basis, went after defense contractors, saying it was outrageous that defense contractors were profiting while ordinary Americans were going, risking their lives to fight the Germans in World War II and the Japanese. And my point is that Democrats should lead a bipartisan coalition to say that the spending there of the defense contractors and the way they're gouging the public is outrageous.
I mean, isn't one of the problems there that defense contractors, it's very, very difficult to know when they are gouging the government, right? I mean, they're the warning systems to tell us when the overruns are real or when they're being padded. It's not a very good system, is it? There aren't sufficient controls there.
There are not sufficient controls, and I think we need to have far more transparency in having the Pentagon disclose what the costs are, making sure that there's a competitive bidding so you don't have just monopoly contractors. You need a president who's going to put people at defense who really are going to look at the costs and the sensitivity of the costs and what the American people are paying. I mean, it's our largest. Think about this for a second. In terms of discretionary federal spending, things that Congress has control over, defense is over half of discretionary federal spending is on the Armed Services Committee where I sit. Don't you think if you're talking about saving government taxpayers' money, you would start with what something that's over half of discretionary spending?
You're also at the one of the people who opposes FOSTA and SESTA, which I think is very brave to do, because a lot of people then portray that as being pro-sex, like pro-trafficking. Can you explain to people why those bills are dangerous?
I appreciate that. I was one of about 20 people who voted against FOSTA, SESTA. And now with Senator Warren, I have a bill that calls for a study of the impact FOSTA, SESTA has had on sex workers. What FOSTA, SESTA does is basically criminalize speech regarding sex work online. And this has led to sex workers, many, by the way, who are women of color or people who are transgender, no longer being able to do that work online where they can screen their clients, have some sense of safety, and they have been forced, frankly, on the streets. And what you have seen is increase in sexual assault, increase in violence against them. And what they're asking for is to be allowed to do some of this work in a way that is safe. The reality is we passed FOSTA SESTA without a single sex worker or sex worker group even offering testimony in Congress. I mean, it's one thing to reject their arguments. Right. It's another thing to not even hear them. And right. So what my bill now calls for is a comprehensive study on what this has done. And frankly, it's made it harder for law enforcement also, because now many of the sites that were having sex work have shut down, and the sex traffickers, which everyone agrees should be right. illegal, they've gone to sites that are not even in the country.
Right, yeah.
Well, lastly, I mean, in terms of the Sanders campaign, you know, as we head out of New Hampshire and towards Super Tuesday, what's your reaction been to the media response to the Sanders campaign? There's been so much overt hostility to the notion of Sanders as a candidate. We have people on panelists who are talking about how can we stop Bernie. Do you feel that there's been bias in the press in covering this presidential campaign?
I think people just need to listen to what Bernie Sanders is actually saying. Here's Bernie Sanders' platform in a nutshell. Everyone in this country should have health care. Everyone in this country should get a decent education. Everyone in this country should have the opportunity to get a good job. Everyone in this country should have child care or some form of ability to raise their kids. I mean, is that really a radical platform?
So scary. I'm scared.
That's what this country gave to me, a son of immigrants. I was born in Philadelphia, and I got to go to a good public school, and I had middle-class parents who were able to make sure that I had a school lunch and didn't have to worry about child care. That's all that Bernie Sanders is saying. He's saying, make sure every American has the chance that Roe had growing up. And you can call that whatever you want. I call that FDR's ultimate vision. I say he's the most Democratic candidate. He's fighting for what the New Deal really was about. So I think that my hope will be that people will say, well, why is Bernie Sanders resonating so much? Right. Why is he getting all this support? Why is he getting a congressman from Silicon Valley supporting him? Does anyone really believe that Bernie Sanders is going to take over Apple computers? No, give me a break. Bernie Sanders is just saying, let's make sure kids get a decent education so they have a chance one day to work at Apple computers. So I think the media needs to look at what about Bernie's campaign is building such a coalition.
But do you think the thing that they find offensive or threatening about Sanders is the fact that he threatens to reduce the influence of big donors because he's just not taking their money? I mean, is that the real subtext to all of this?
I think that's part of it. I think the broader part is he challenges the entire infrastructure of power. He was a backbencher in the House at one point, and he's now become a leading voice in the Senate, but it's not through the traditional means. And so if he were a president, you'd have different people appointed to all of the positions. It wouldn't be the traditional individuals, and you'd have different people running the Democratic Party. And that's a real challenge to the status quo. And I do think that that's part of what makes people really uneasy about Bernie Sanders. I mean, he's reforming the party, but I believe he's taking it back to the party's roots. I mean, the question is, is this a progressive party? Roosevelt said his goal in the New Deal was to make the Democrats a progressive party. And really, that's Bernie Sanders' goal.
Who's the best dancer among all the surrogates and the campaign? Because we saw Nina Turner and Dr. Cornel West really tearing it up on the.
Can you compete with that?
Well, Dr. West and Nina Turner are amazing. And, you know, if they're on a scale of 1 to 10, a 10, I'm a 0. So, you know, there are probably people in between. But, you know, Bernie's not bad. I don't know if you've seen the clip of him dancing in New Hampshire with one of the volunteers. One of the things that people don't realize about Sanders, and I've gotten to obviously know him quite well this year and being in Congress, is he has a great sense of humor, a dry sense of humor. Yeah. He's actually likes cracking jokes. Often they're, you know, like grandfather, uncle jokes, but they're jokes nonetheless. He's very comfortable in his own skin, and he doesn't really take criticism personally or seriously. And that quality, I think, is so important, especially when you're running for president.
Yeah. He's also saved people's lives, despite Chris Matthews saying that he wouldn't pull over to help someone.
Yeah, he's a very decent person who's in politics for the right reasons. And this is something that the polling shows, because you can't fake it when you run for president. You kind of, your personality comes out. And even people who disagree with Bernie Sanders, who don't want him as president, say, we can trust him. And I've heard this so many times, even from Republicans in Iowa, where I spent time in New Hampshire, some people saying, we'll never vote for your guy, but you know what? We trust him. We believe he believes what he's saying.
Yeah, that he's honest, right?
Yeah.
Congressman, thank you so much for taking the time. We really appreciate it.
Thank
you
so much.
Good luck out on the trail.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on. I'm a big fan of your podcast, and I hope you keep doing it. It's an important voice out there.
Thanks. We will.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
That was great.
I learned something today.
You know what I learned?
What did you learn?
I learned that my policy versus politics line is really good.
It is. That was incisive.
I hope that he realizes that I'm being self-deprecating. I think he
does,
right?
Is that what you're being now, self-deprecating?
Now I'm celebrating myself.
Oh, okay. All right.
But during the interview, I was being self-deprecating. Yeah, that was great, though.
He was great. He's a super smart guy. I think one of the things about him that's really interesting, for all the money we spend on defense, there are very few members in both the House and the Senate who make defense spending their thing.
Right.
In other words, who want to be the go-to people on defense, on let's say, the problems with defense spending.
Right, on problematizing it, on interrogating it. Look, button.
Yeah. You know, there are people who obviously who are key in soliciting, you know, the business of the big five defense companies and all that. But there's only a couple who are in the business of looking for the financial problems and, you know, or worrying about overruns. You know, Bernie's obviously one.
Yeah.
Chuck Grassley is another one with spending.
Weird, right.
No,
terrible.
Well, I mean,
terrible politics
it's,
usually.
It's
but
a fiscal, it's a fiscal thing.
Right,
you know?
So, no, I know there is overlap.
But he's, you know, he's taken up the mantle now in the House as a young member. I think it's really good to see. And, you know, I think he showed a lot of leadership in
December.
A lot of courage, when the rest of the caucus wasn't so with him on that, which was really good.
Right.
You know.
Well, I mean, he's no Nancy Pelosi. He's not ripping up speeches.
Right.
So he'll never be quite as powerful and significant and substantive, but he can try.
Right. He'll never reach there, but he can maybe.
He'll never
What do you think?
Pelosian Heights.
Pelosian Heights?
Yeah.
Mount Pelosi?
Yeah, Mount Pelosi. That's really good.
Yeah, excellent.
Speaking of soliciting and bravery, he's pretty good on Fosta Sesta.
Right. Okay. I realized that was what the connection you were going to make there is.
Yeah, I know. I saw it is brave. And it really is one of those things where I get very frustrated by people's takes on. So Fosta Sesta is the it's an anti-trafficking bill. But the problem is people conflate trafficking with sex work. And a lot of people are really interested in their own feelings and thoughts about it, but not in sex workers. And that's what I don't mean, interested in what's better for them.
Right.
And
not just interested in sex workers.
Right. There's a lot of interest in that. Woke. Okay. Problematic. Yeah. By the way, I'm doing woke in two ways. When I say something that sounds very academic-y and like something that a person who considers himself woke would say, like interrogate, I tap it. And then when I do something that's not woke, I just want to.
I see. Okay. Because I was pretty much doing just the latter.
Exactly. I just felt, I wanted to spice it up a little bit. But yeah, it's really brave of him to be there because, again, people, it's so puritanical and it's so like, does anyone actually think sex work is ever going to go away? Like, when are we going to live in a society that doesn't have that? And so people get lost in there like, oh, it's inherently oppressive. I don't really care what you think of it. Like, I care about, and who cares about what I care about? The important thing isn't people's like hot takes on sex work and whether it's empowering or demeaning. There's so many jobs that we could call demeaning. We don't make them illegal. We don't force them into the underground, into the underbelly. Like, it's not going to go away. It's obviously safer when it's not illegal. You're much less vulnerable.
Yeah.
So it just seems like very self-indulgent and self-righteous and moralistic. And you have people who are like, the most annoying to me are the ones who consider themselves like feminists. Well, they're really annoying when they're men, like male allies who are like, "Why? I don't want to, like, what is the messaging that women are commodities?" It's like, yeah, that sucks.
Right.
Like, and would you rather them be dead on the street?
Right.
And in dumpsters?
Yeah.
So you could be like, we're sending the right message.
Yeah. I think those folks are usually disingenuous. It's similar to me to the way people are about prohibition on drugs.
It is similar,
it's just like, okay, the more you enact really, really harsh laws to stop something, to prohibit something, like the more elaborate the workarounds become.
Right.
And then those become problems.
Right.
And then, you know, so just find a way to like make your peace with it.
Yeah.
And,
it's harm reduction.
Yeah.
I don't care what you think about it. You don't have to do it.
Right.
That's the other thing. People are like, well, would you want your boyfriend to go to a prostitute? It's like, no, but there are lots of things I wouldn't want my boyfriend to do that don't need to be illegal.
Right.
I wouldn't want him to vote for Mayor Pete.
Right.
Maybe that should be illegal. I want to make that illegal before I make sex work illegal.
Would you want your boyfriend to get high on coke, abduct a child, and rob a bank?
At the same time?
Yeah.
No, because that'll distract.
Okay.
I want him to do one at a time.
Right, okay. In sequence.
I mean, to be fair, if he were as prolific and coordinated as that guy we talked about last week who fought off 12 cops while masturbating,
right,
then he could do it. But
right.
I don't want him to...
Oh, if he had only robbed a bank in the middle of that, that would have been really
funny.
That would have been amazing. Isn't that
weird? In blackface.
Remember that other guy?
Then,
it's a Halloween costume idea next year.
Yeah.
All right.
One question quickly. Speaking of wokery, so wait, they actually incorporated like a Family Leave Act into...
In the defense bill, there was a measure that gave federal workers some family leave. So that was part of the horse trading between the Democrats and Jared Kushner, if I'm not mistaken, who handled the Republicans, the negotiations from the Republican side or from the White House side. So they got all sorts of things they caved on, like the Yemen stuff.
Right.
The AUMF stuff, which didn't get repealed until after the Soleimani thing, if I'm not mistaken. So
that is amazing. So they're like, they're giving women, that's like pro-women's rights, right? Like the Family Leave Act. I mean, it's for men too, but in theory, a lot of it comes from like the need to let women take off time from work.
Well, it's federal workers, but then of course they got a lot more on the other end, right? They got the... You know, the $738 billion in defense spending.
I know. I'm just saying it's like amazing. Like, I can't stand the like pink drones or whatever that, like, you know, like Lockheed Martin having women do X, Y, and Z. Woke imperialism.
Right. Yeah,
that's what this is. I'm tired of it being separate. Like, you don't get to be progressive on domestic issues and not on international. You do, but you're just a hypocrite.
Right.
You get the big wag of the finger.
Right. Which you also get if you listen to Pod Save America.
Oh, my God. Big time. Even more than ever.
Which is why you should subscribe.
Rate, review,
and subscribe.
You can mention Pod Save America in the review if you want.
Yeah, pejoratively.
Of course.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Say the filthiest thing the
human filth that is Pod Save America.
Get yourself banned from the internet. Find a way. Use language so repulsive that even we will shudder.
Last thing I want to point out that he's like, why are people scared of Bernieism? There is something scary. There's the threat of free chocolate milk.
Free chocolate milk. That's right.
A specter is haunting the United States.
I could use some free chocolate milk.
Yeah.
My God. My
Me too.
Kids they drink so much of it. Anyway, rate, review, and subscribe.
Yeah. You can find us on YouTube. You can find us on iTunes. You can find us on Google, all the places where you listen to podcasts. Oh, yeah. I know where you're going.
Buy merch.
Buy merch.
Buy these amazing mugs, yes, which make terrific gifts. And thank you so much for listening to the show.
Yeah, and thank you, Ro Connor.